And today we are embarking on a very important journey, a journey that we bring us deeper and deeper into our understanding of one very specific topic that is so vital to our faith, so essential to our understanding of who God is and the history of humanity, that God would be bold enough to suggest that if you fail to understand this one topic, this one subject, that you fail to understand it. If you do not understand this concept, you will not understand this is what God says or does or asks you to say. That our view of this singular topic shapes our very understanding of what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. This one word transforms. It transforms your view of who God is and why He does what He does and has done what He has done. And it is interesting because it also transforms your understanding of who God is not and why He has not said or done perhaps something that you really wish He had said or done. In addition to that, it also sheds light on our relationship with one another. If we fail to understand this key concept, then the relationships in our lives, relationships that we truly cherish and value, can very easily fall into disrepair and possibly fail. But on the other hand, on the brighter side, when you finally absorb the reality, the totality of this truth, it brings beautiful clarity into the world. It naturally draws you closer and closer to your relationship with God, and awakens a deep sense of joy and happiness. Friends, I would love to introduce you to grace. Is the single most liberating, joy-infusing, hope-generating, wound-healing, spirit-lifting, life-giving thing on the face of this earth. Because understanding this topic is so vital, so important, beginning today, we will start a brand new series of sermons titled What's So Amazing About Grace? You might not be there yet, but I am so excited about this series because it means that over the next several weeks, we get to talk about grace in many, many different ways to impact not only our lives, but our understanding of grace. We look at Psalm 145:8. It says that God is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and meek. When you read that, you think, "What in the world does it mean? What does it mean to say that God is gracious? What is this thing we call grace, and why is it so amazing?" Well, if you'll come back next week, you know, I'm telling you. When you think about it, we say that by waiting, we say grace before being. But this is to know that there are grace needs. It's confusing. So, what is the thing we talk about? I just want you to know that I have never found one all encompassing definition that covers the depth and beauty of the word grace, but I have found three that I find to be superior. Now, the first two, I'm not going to say, my favorite one here. Okay. So, here's the first one. God giving me what I need, not what I deserve. Another definition puts it this way: grace is the faith that God makes and the gift that comes through. My personal favorite is one I have taken from several other definitions and forced them into one that really like. Here is my very favorite definition of grace. Grace is God's unmerited favor, showered upon those who do not deserve it, have not earned it, grace is God's unmerited favor. All of us who pour out of that grace, we do not deserve, have not earned it, to be covered in grace. So when we say that God is gracious, we're saying that God loves to bless you, we do not deserve, have not earned it, to be covered. One thing that will be extremely helpful for us is to make sure we have a clear understanding of the difference between justice, grace, and mercy. Because they're not the same. Here we go. Let's dive on in. Justice is when God gives you what you deserve. It's justice. Mercy is when God does not give you what you deserve. And grace is when God does give you that which you do not deserve. Let me give you an example from a previous year. If you are caught speeding, and the police officer pulls you over and gives you a ticket, that is justice. If you are speeding, you're guilty of speeding. If you get caught speeding, the police officer comes up to your window and says, license, registration, insurance, please, you were doing 107, 6.5, or something, just tell yourself. You're guilty of speeding, but he says, I'm not giving you that. I'm not giving you that. That's the word. Perfect. That's the word. That's one. Once you are speeding, the police officer pulls you over. They say you're doing 107, 55 miles an hour zone. Here's a ticket from here. You sign the ticket. When the officer takes the ticket back from you, puts your ticket to the courthouse, and pays to your guilty plea, pays in fine for you. Now, as amazing and as incredible as that is, I just want you to know, in all my years of law enforcement, I've never seen that happen. But it's a very different thing, isn't it? Giving you, someone giving you that which you do not deserve. It's so because when you really begin to understand, it brings such joy and freedom into your life. It brings peace. Sometimes it takes the most subtle shift from our understanding to bring about that transformation. A story of illustration. Did you know words can be transformed? I think they can be one. For example, water. Not my favorite word, but change one letter and it becomes laughter. You see the next word? Change one letter and laughter becomes daughter. Now, one of our least favorite words, rage. It's supposed to take one, isn't it? My point is that you will transform from having one foot in the grave having one foot in his kingdom. And throughout this sermon series, Let's be very clear upon the goal of this group. This is like a 5, 6, 8 group. This is 7 But let's be clear on the goal of this entire group. The goal is not new information, the goal is transformation. But we, all of us, myself included, would not just understand grace intellectually, but that we would experience it, that we would feel it, that we would begin to truly enjoy the grace of God in our day-to-day lives, and enjoy it in His form. And the transition from information to transformation is absolutely vital and beautiful. If we merely have an intellectual, academic understanding of grace, it doesn't take long for us to understand. And it's possible to extend grace in an ungracious manner. Grace that is merely information that has not brought about personal transformation. We should be wide open for conversations like this. You can't if you care before the third big day of that person, and you don't like him, and you know as well as I do that you don't deserve this, but I'm more smarter than you, so here, take this, I'm so smart, I know that me giving you something you don't deserve is great, so here you care before the third big day of that person, take it, give me what I'm doing, you know. Don't be deceived because it's not also sound like this. Just giving someone something they don't deserve, but it's extending grace in an ungracious manner. And when you remove grace from gracious, the rest is possible. Grace which can cause an obligation is not possible. Grace which can cause an obligation. Informational grace also has a way of completely distorting our understanding of the unit of God. Somehow, people over the years have developed this image of God as this unreasonable, overpowering God with a giant red feather and a giant mallet. Completely watching over everything you say or do, just anticipating and pleading for you to do something back to the question. If the good side of the scale outweighs the bad side of the scale, God will look at me and say, good girl, good boy, good job, you got it, well done.
come on in. But if you don't do those things, God says, forget it, you fail, you're worthless, the top door opens up, and whoop, there you go. The one that can fall perceive and try to destroy and kill how he's in charge. What is paying justice? The entire family is content. But now King David is going to hunt him down and kill his enemy. So they all come. One of the ones leading for his son was Jonathan's son, the king. And this is where the story is interesting. The little children was only 5 years old when he was dead. And the nurse was carrying him home, the king for their lives, the king for their lives, the king for their lives. So here we have this young, disabled boy living in the field, fighting for his life, afraid that the man who is now king would retaliate against him because he was compromised. So a few years later, here's what David says. If the king was still alive, he's going to have him. That's a true promise. The job is, there's one little kid, his name is the Philistine, but he can't walk. And David goes on and he says, wow, what a name. I think they call him David for short. No, I don't think. He says, bring him to you. Can you imagine if you place yourself into this story? Can you imagine the utter fear and terror in the Philistine? Here is his grandfather's Jesus Christ, the warrior king that invited him in to the king's house. It's hard to lift up what he's trying to do. He's trying to be gentle in the world. It's good, it's over, it's done, it's finished, it's been killed, executed, and it's done. As he arrives at the king's house, not a servant of the king that comes out to do it. It's the king himself. In fact, the king himself, King David, gives him to be the first. And so the gift, don't be afraid. I am king to protect the Christ. Because of my promise to the king of God, I will give you all the property that comes from all the people. I'm going to go to the next one.
I'm going to go to the next one.
I'm going to go to the next one.